realize that I'm in a university where chemistry and biology are in one faculty. Actually, it's biology and chemistry. And I wonder why you chose that order. You can discuss this formatively, whether you could pick the either one or the other one. The lecture will be about biology and chemistry, but I will start with chemistry to some extent. I will go along and introduce to you the philosophy that my lab follows. I will illustrate it with a few examples, and I hope for a diversified lecture like the one I'm addressing today, I will have a few examples of each of their fields. You'll see some chemistry, you will see some biology, you will see how we try to figure out some of the myths that nature presents us. I would like to start off introducing the topic by reflecting for a few seconds about how I see the a major development in the biological sciences over the last 10 to 20 years. When I started off in the field, it was all about molecular details. How would a protein look? How would a DNA look? How would they interact with each other? Molecular basis of biological problems were very much in the focus of the field. Reductionist approach, one would say, in the philosophical. Then over the years, increasingly, the story became more complex. I should say, became more complex again. Proteins were arranged in signaling cascades. Signaling cascades would talk to each other. They would be linked with each other. An engineering approach at what in these days is called systems biology was developed over the time. However, it became clear rapidly, and I must say, I'm embedded as a chemistry group in a biology institute, but ultimately what we have to be able to do is to understand biology in its entirety, in its dynamics, in its resolution in terms of space and in terms of time. It's completely clear that the biology community itself has developed numerous very, very powerful techniques to do so. And I'd say this is the stronghold where they are. Let me stress, though, that there is a place for chemistry in this field, but chemistry has advantages that are not easily or not at all matched by a biological technique. That has to do with the fact that small molecules, drugs, you may think, drug-like molecules, have a set of properties that distinguish them from a biological methodology. Summarizingly, one could say they act in an acute manner, but they are not chronic. I mean by that they, for instance, act rapidly. Expose a cell or an animal or yourself to a small molecule, you get a headache, you swallow an aspirin, and rapidly you get a change of the system. Your headache goes away. You can expect it in cells within seconds to minutes. Whereas in a typical biological technique, it will take hours, days, sometimes even weeks, but gets time resolution. I'll show you one example where time resolution is decisive. Reversible, diffuse it in, begins its action, and it can come out again. And most notably, it perturbs a complex biological system, but it doesn't change it. If you would knock out the protein from the very beginning, it's gone. The system itself is changed. A small molecule allows to perturb, but not to change. It can easily be tuned, we vary the concentration, and finally, it's conditional. Imagine a protein should be studied at day 5 of development of an organism. Knocking it out means it's gone from day 1. With a chemical method, you can do it at any point in time. These are properties which are advantageous and which often call for the development of a chemical method to study biology. That is so, from a chemistry point of view, and I'm a trained synthetic organic chemist, I define myself as one, this comes then down to a very, very simple question. And the question is, well, which molecule shall we make? One answer could be that we try to adopt the methodology of biology, genetics, to apply to chemistry. Genetics will generate a huge number. You could generate them all and then select the ones which are appropriate. Can this be done in a chemical setting? The answer simply is no, it cannot. Because it comes to what I refer to as the space problem. How big is the number of thinkable chemical molecules that have typical drug-like properties? A certain molecular weight, certain atoms in there, hydrogen bond donors and acceptors. The answer is, it's so high that if we want to make meaningful amounts of each of them, say a few milligrams, the matter in the entire universe would not be sufficient to do so. And even if we could synthesize at a speed that is much higher than we can do today, say make trillions of different molecules per year, by the end of all times, more than 10 to the 40 combinations would not have been made. Or in other words, The basic thinking of genetics cannot be applied to chemistry. It's different. And there's a second Gedanken experiment, as we say in German. We shouldn't even try to do so, because in all evolution, when nature also generated small molecules, natural products, and there's a rich history of natural products in Asia, particularly in China, with its traditional medicine, nature never ever could have explored this space, this structure space. There's a second Gedanken experiment that the biochemists made more than 50 years ago. Imagine the planet would have been covered by an ocean from the beginning of all times on. This ocean has exactly one inhabitant, it's a single cell. It makes one protein. It makes it the speed of biosynthesis as it is today, has 250 amino acids. In all evolution, nature could have created approximately 10 to the 50 combinations of amino acids in there. That's a big number, but compared to 10 to the 250, which is the theoretical possibility, it's very, very small. So we cannot make it. Evolution never explored it all, so we shouldn't even attempt to make all of them. Scientifically, making all of them is the wrong approach. The question is different. The question is how, in this enormously huge chemical space, you might call it, how do we find starting points for synthesis that are relevant to biology, of which we already know why they are relevant to biology, validation, pre-validation, how do we find them? And if you have a logic how to find them, how can we use this idea to reason forward and to develop what would be a predictive methodology? Big question. No answer. I can't answer it. Nobody, I think, can answer it. But that's not important, because science is very readily faced with exactly such questions. The 19th century people couldn't imagine a movie to fly to the moon. By now, we've been there. There are two principal ways, philosophically, how we can deal with that. One of is the method of induction, the other one is the method of deduction. It goes back to the ancient scientists. Induction would be, we turn around and ask what has been successful so far, and what can we learn from it to have a logic for it.